him, I went and asked him if he would teach me. And I played a little bit for him, and I played the guitar, you know, and I was hoping he could teach me some rather scales. And he said, well, you have some good musical talent, but I can't teach you on the guitar. If you want to learn ragas, you've got to learn sitar. And I said, but I don't. Okay. So there's a thing in Zen called Zen mind, beginner's mind. And there I went from being someone who was felt fairly proficient on the guitar after playing it for 12 or 15 years to being an absolute beginner again. And there's always something there. In that book, Zen Mind, Beginner's Mind, Suzuki Roshi says, in the expert's mind, there's no room to learn anything because he knows everything. But in the beginner's mind, there's lots of room to learn. So I was a beginner, and I was studying the sitar. And it's a big instrument, you know. It has lots of strings, and it's tuned differently. And I spent the first 3 months just learning how to hold the instrument. And then I learned my first raga. And first I learned scales. And he sent me home and said, just practice scales for a while. And then he taught me my first composition, raga Iman Kayam. And I learned it and I practiced it a lot. And after about a year, he said, we're having our student recital that we have every year at the Indian consulate in the Netherlands. And my son, you will play. And I said, oh, Guruji, I'm not ready to play. I'm just a beginner. And he said, no, you'll play. You'll play around the game on Kalyan. It will be fine. And I will accompany you on the tablets. I said, I'm still not sure. He said, listen, if you miss a note, just smile and keep playing. No one will know but me, and I won't tell. If you miss a beat, I will cover for you because I'm playing drums, tabla. But if you play out of tune, I will kill you. So a lot of what I perceive as what has been going on here this weekend is a kind of a tuning. That we're tuning, you know, I'm tuning this instrument as I'm talking to you. I keep adjusting it a little bit because it's constantly being influenced by forces beyond our perception. Little changes in heat and humidity in the room will make the strings change. Likewise, this mandala that we have been creating over the last 2 days of constantly shifting stories and listening and thinking about what somebody else said, reflecting back on it and taking in, how does that relate to my story? Is it similar or different? And I think after a while, we begin to realize that underneath it all, we're a lot more similar than we are different, right? So just thinking about how similar you are. Good luck with that. So, as we've been learning about and being reminded about the relationship between breathing and mind, the relationship between unconsciously held tension. See, that's your mind wandering around and looking for a place to settle down. And dogs will do this. Seriously, have you ever watched? Dogs and cats will do this, and they will circle around. And it's leftover from, it's a from when they were out wild on the savannah. That's what we're all trying to do, is make a comfortable spot for ourselves. It's only temporary, because tomorrow we'll get up and we'll go around and we are having other adventures, like a sweat lodge, for instance. We don't know what other adventures we're going to have tomorrow, but we will be having other adventures. Theme of this past couple of days, what was it that we set for our intention? Springtime. Working in the story garden. It's not the summer when the crops are already starting to show themselves and the flowers have bloomed. Seedlings have come up, and certainly not the fall when we're reaping the fruits of our harvest. It's the springtime, beginning. What are the seeds that have been planted here yesterday? Them may have been intentional. Others, like that poem, may have shot out the ass of a blue jay that just flew overhead. We don't know. There's certain random. So we set our intention, and learning the fine line between having an intention and adhering rigidly to it in the face of circumstance that says change course. So imagine walking through now, a couple of months from now, imagine seeing yourself walking as if you were a bird flying far overhead. And you see yourself below, walking there so calmly in the garden that contains a poem by Yeats that said, what if you slept? And what if in your sleep you dreamt? And what if in that dream you went to heaven? what if you pick that flower? And what if when you awoke, that flower was in your hand? What then? Walking through your garden, I don't know if it's a garden of edible things or they used to have these things called victory gardens. Maybe it's a victory garden that you face some challenge or adversity. You came out the other side victorious. But simply admiring the beauty. And taking some justifiable pride in what you have created. Again, that's one of those double-edged swords, isn't it? They say you can trip on the foot of pride. But on the other hand, to take some credit, to feel a sense of accomplishment. I remember the inklings that I had there back in early April at the nest. It's just an inkling, just a seed of an idea. Now I'm looking at this beautiful flower. Here it is. And as you look closer, you see that there are a myriad of life forms around it. There are ants crawling around. There are earthworms. There are bees. Pollinate, landing on that flower, carrying, just as we have here today and yesterday, cross-pollinating. Unknowingly, we have all been infected with each other's enthusiasms and dreams. Connections, and I don't know if you've ever had this experience where you meet someone and you don't even realize at the moment the depth of connection you have, and then months or years later I look back and I say, I remember the very exact moment that I met you. I remember looking at you and thinking, you look so familiar. Is it possible that we can have future memory? That we can actually remember that we're going to know someone when we meet them at that moment? There's a transmission. Missionaries. So I challenge you, as you go back out into the world, and we've got a ways to go, hopefully we'll all be in that lodge, sweating our prayers tomorrow, taking this to yet another level, but you go out into that world, you go back there amongst all your relations, the whole Takuyasin. The people that have not been in this wonderful temenos, in this cauldron of creation. And you're interacting with them. Can we be like that candle that lights other candles? I mean, you know, which has been kept at home, no, but that which has been given, yes. Which has been given, that is mine. Whatever has been kept at home is not. That which has been given, that is meaningful. Whatever has been kept at home is not. One doesn't seek to guard what has been given. One seeks to guard what has been kept at home. That which has been given, that is without fear. Whatever has been kept at home is ridden with anxiety. What has been given, that reveals the path to enlightenment. What has been kept at home is to the benefit of illusion. That which has been given will be greatly enjoyed. Whatever has been kept at home will not. That which has been given has never been known to become exhausted. Whatever has been kept at home soon does. In the Buddhist teaching of the six perfections, the paramitas, the very first one is generosity. And then we are gently reminded, oh, and remember to be generous to yourself as well. It was as if we had moved, you know, in school when the bell would ring, it was the end of one period, and you'd get up and go into the hallway, and go, everybody would be shuffling past you, and you'd go to the next class, it's the start of the next period. So here we are, it's the end of that period, and, or maybe it wasn't a period, it might have been a semicolon. It could have been, or a comma. Maybe you're having a comma, or a comma, or a semicolon. And maybe your colon is intact, and you have your whole colon, both your ascending and your descending and your transverse colon. I don't know, but it's very good for digestion, and that's what we've been doing: is digesting here, digesting all the experience. You know, Trungpa Rinpoche also talked about the manure of experience.